The U.S. House of Representatives passes a defense policy bill that includes a record $886 billion in annual military spending. The National Defense Authorization Act also includes aid for Ukraine and pushback against China's influence in the Indo-Pacific. The 310 to 118 vote was more than the two-thirds majority required to pass the measure. It will now be sent to the White House for President Joe Biden's signature. Speaking of Asian markets, optimism among bankers in the region for initial public offerings is growing as global interest rates stabilize. Data from London Stock Exchange show high interest rates, sticky inflation, and geopolitical tensions have put share sales this year by Asia-Pacific companies on course to be the weakest in more than a decade. But bankers say sentiment has improved as central banks across the globe, particularly America's Fed, signal looming rate cuts for next year. They, however, warn that windows for companies to come to market for funds would be tight and tough to navigate as elections get underway. That's because businesses are typically reluctant to make major deal decisions as political activity in countries heats up. Here at home, Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. flies to Tokyo for the 50th anniversary of the ASEAN-Japan Commemorative Summit. The visit is viewed as significant to the Philippines, as Japan remains to be one of the country's major economic partners, as well as among the first dialogue partners of ASEAN. Defense and regional issues, along with legal assistance and economic affairs, are expected to be discussed among participating leaders. Japanese Prime Minister Fumio Kishida will host President Marcos for a dinner on Saturday night. Another bilateral meeting is also scheduled between the two leaders.
This last ASEAN-related summit for the year presents an opportunity to once again affirm the Philippines' position on current international issues and advance Philippine interests. It is also an opportunity to welcome the conferment of comprehensive partner status to Japan, ASEAN's trusted and reliable partner in peace, economic development, and community building for the past 50 years. I shall reassure ASEAN member states and Japan that as a permanent country coordinator for ASEAN-Japan economic relations, the Philippines will always continue to shepherd ASEAN initiatives and projects with Japan, not only to co-create a region of economic prosperity, but also an inclusive society that is ready for the future.
Marcos returns to the Philippines on Monday, December 18. In the meantime, Vice President Sara Duterte has been designated as the government's caretaker. President Marcos looking into whether amendments to the Constitution are necessary to attract more investments. His remarks come as the House of Representatives revive proposals to amend the 1987 Charter. The chief executive says there have been talks about the Constitution's economic provisions possibly getting in the way of potential investors.
What we are looking at here is the opportunity cost of those who would like to invest here, but somehow the laws that derive from the Constitution when it comes to the economic provisions do not allow them to, or make it non-viable for them. My primary interest is to try and make our country a investment-friendly place. And whatever we'll see. That's why the study is really not about the Constitution. It's about what do we need to do, what do we need to change so that these potential investors will in fact come to the Philippines.
For a political analyst, changing the Constitution cannot be done in piecemeal. Professor Edmund Tayo says amendments should be systemic to make them more effective.
When you open up the country for investment, and you will have the same kind of agencies, you will have the same kind of politics. It's as if we just simply sold. We put out the word in the world that hey, this country is for sale, because anyone can just come in if they have money to burn. then they can basically do what they want, considering that government agencies are not prepared and not organized to respond to so much, demands, no? New demands as a result of opening up the economies.
And speaking of agriculture, the Philippines' agriculture chief looks to the private sector to support the modernization of the country's farms and fisheries industries. Secretary Francisco Chu Laurel Jr. spoke Thursday at an Agriculture Volunteers Day celebration. He says such collaboration is crucial in increasing food production and ensuring food security for 118 million Filipinos. Laurel has been meeting with investors, industry experts, and other stakeholders to drum up support for government's push for food self-sufficiency, as well as the agency's efforts to make agriculture a career option for the younger generation. Money sent home by overseas Filipinos pick up in October. Personal remittances jumped by 3.1% in the said month on increased remittances from land and sea-based workers. Total personal remittances for the first 10 months of the year reached $30 billion, reflecting a nearly 3% increase year-on-year. Cash remittances coursed through banks saw a similar increase due to increased receipts from both land and sea-based workers. The Philippine Central Bank says the U.S. registered the highest share to overall remittances during the January to October period, followed by Singapore and Saudi Arabia.